Jesus' name. Let's stand and worship him this morning.
Hard enough to hear, harder still to move. With us, my heart sings a brand new Good morning. We gather here around this table of communion to remember what Jesus did for us. This morning, I want to focus on the message Jesus told his disciples before he was to be crucified. In the book of John, chapter 16, verse 33, Jesus said, "I have told you these things so that you may have peace. In this world, you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world." How many of you want more peace in your life? If you are anything like me, then your answer would be yes. There are many things that can rob you of your peace. I would like to suggest comparison is one of them. When we compare ourselves against another. I once heard it said that comparison is the thief of joy. I think it could be also said that comparison is the thief of peace. There is only one person we should compare ourselves to, and that is Jesus. We will never be equal to him, but we can try to be more like him. Perhaps you compare your life to another's and wish that you had as many friends as they do, or you are jealous of the relationship they have with their family, their parents, their spouse, their brothers and sisters, their neighbors, their children. Maybe you look at someone else's family that seems so perfect and wonder why you can't have that. Or could it be a job, a house, a truck, a car, a tractor, a piece of land? Or you look at someone else and wonder how they have so much time to do the thing that you want to do. There's an endless list of things that can steal our peace. You can get a nicer house or a bigger boat or anything else I have listed, but it won't satisfy. You will just start to compare yourself with someone else who has what you don't. Thankfully, we have Jesus who came to give us peace. He is the Prince of Peace. He didn't say it would be easy, but I don't know of any other way to get the peace that Jesus offers. If you're here today and have not yet accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, then please use this time to think about how you are getting peace in your life and if Jesus has something more to offer. And for those about to participate in this communion meal, consider using this time to shift your focus to the Prince of Peace, the only one who can give us everlasting peace. Philippians 4, verse 6 and 7. "Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus." Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the sacrifice of your Son, Lord, that came to this earth to give us peace. What an incredible sacrifice that was. And we are all so thankful for it. Lord, I pray for peace for everyone in this room. Lord, and we thank you for everything Jesus does for us. Let us reflect on that now. In Jesus' name, amen.
Excuse me, sir. You need to. No, don't try it. You've tried it before. It doesn't work. They make me stop here. You have to stop there. It does look. It's got to be fun, right? I mean, they all get up and leave, and it's like sometime we need to slip in or walk low or something. Anyway, I'm sorry. It's time for our third week Next Generation Minister Search Update. So as a reminder, remember, the Next Gen Minister is someone who works with young people from the sixth grade up through their early 20s. So that range of ages, you know, just recognizes the need for us to intentionally stay involved with our young people into their early 20s, and you know, regardless of what path they choose after high school. Now, earlier in April, we shared with you that we had received a response. Now, that did not work out as we had hoped. But I'm happy to tell you today that we have received two responses since then through our the Waypoint Church Partners, who is helping us with this process. And just as a reminder, that response is not like receiving a resume. It's receiving a sometimes 5 to 7 page filled out questionnaire, which serves very similar to a first interview. Excuse me. So we are evaluating those responses now. So please continue to pray and fast. We need that. God's guiding this process, and we're trusting Him. And just let's keep going. Let's keep going. Thank you.
Thank you, Mike. We're excited about the possibilities. God has His timing, and we're going to trust that. And that's kind of what we're going to be talking about in the message today. For the last couple of weeks, we've been looking at the idea of roadblocks to faith. You know, some people, I think, would like to believe in God, but there's something that's keeping them from it. There as an idea or a thought or something that's just keeping them from being able to put their faith in God. And we talked about how a lot of times I think the God people reject is not the God of the Bible, but a distorted view of God. And so we talked the first week about on-demand God. I want to believe in God, but He doesn't do what I ask. And so we talked about the fact that on-demand God doesn't exist, but we have someone so much better. We have someone who loved us enough that He sacrificed Himself for us. Last week, we talked about killjoy God. You know, I want to believe in God, but God doesn't let me do what I want. There are just too many rules. And we talked about the fact that God made things simple, and we created religion, and we created all these extra things that have complicated what God made simple. Well, today, we're going to talk about, might be one of the more difficult ones, and that's the idea that I want to believe in God, but it doesn't seem like God cares, right? We look around. I don't know about you, but I've known several people over the years who they're at that point where they say, you know, I would believe in God. I kind of want to believe in God, but I look around and I see all this stuff going on that just isn't right. Or they've had a trauma in their life and they cried out to God and God didn't respond the way they had hoped He would. And they're just left saying, you know, I want to believe in God, but it just doesn't seem like He cares. And maybe that's you. Maybe you've had something happen. You've had a trauma in your life, and you've cried out to God, and He didn't respond the way you had hoped He would, and you're left thinking, "Wow, God, are you there? Do you really care about what I'm going through?" And it may not even be something traumatic. It may just be that you look at your news feed every day, right, and you see crime, and you see terrorism, and you see natural disasters. We saw those incredibly huge tornadoes this week that did so much destruction in the Midwest. And having lived in Tornado Alley in southwest Missouri for several years, I can empathize because I was so scared of those. And you see the destruction, and it's easy to look at and just go, okay, God, well, if you care, Why does all this happen? And it may not even be anything big. It just may be that you look around and you see people who do terrible things, And it looks like they're wealthy and successful. And you see people who are trying to do the right thing, and they're just struggling to make ends meet. And it's easy to look and say, okay, God, if you're there, why does all this happen? It doesn't seem like you care. And if that's you, then can I tell you, you're in good company, because there are a number of people, and I think honestly, pretty much all of us have some times in our life where we have those questions for God. About 29 years ago, Christy and I were living in Tidewater, and one Wednesday night we were driving to church for a Bible study that I was leading there, and we stopped to get gas, and when we finished filling the tank, we went to leave, and the car wouldn't start. And I'm cranking it, and nothing. And we're running behind, which is one of those things that drives me crazy because I hate being late. And I'm looking at this, and I'm going, okay, God, come on, help me out here. And it just won't. I raised the hood of the car like I have any idea what I'm even looking at. I have no idea. And then there's a line of cars piling up because they need to get gas too. I'm making friends all over the place. Finally, I put the hood down and we push it out of the way. But at this point, I'm just really frustrated because I'm thinking, I don't have time for this. I don't have money right now to get a car fixed. I sure don't have money if the thing is dead to get a new car. And I start arguing with God. You ever done that? Now, I didn't do it out loud because that'd just be kind of weird. But in my mind, I'm arguing with God. God, what is going on here? I mean, the whole reason we're out tonight, I could be at home, but we're out tonight because I'm leading a Bible study at church. I'm doing this for you. And I don't have money for this. And you can just understand the rant. I'm going on and on and on in my mind and going, I'm doing this for you. Why? Why does this happen? And there are times when we have those questions. Now, it was not my finest moment, okay? I look back on that now, and I kind of shake my head. But in that moment, all I saw was my problem. And my question was, okay, God, what? Where are you here? And if you've ever looked in the Bible, you realize there are plenty of people who have been through the same type of thing and had the same type of thoughts. King David, who God described as a man after his own heart, that he chose him to be king of Israel. He was going through a time when his life was in danger, when Saul was trying to kill him. And listen to what he wrote in Psalm 13. Verse 1 says, "O Lord, how long will you forget me? Forever? How long will you look the other way? How long must I struggle with anguish in my soul, with sorrow in my heart every day? How long will my enemy have the upper hand? Turn and answer me, O Lord my God. Restore the sparkle to my eyes, or I will die. Don't let my enemies gloat, saying, 'We have defeated him.' Don't let them rejoice at my downfall." Listen to how desperate he sounds here. And have you ever heard of Job? I mean, he's a really righteous person, and Satan comes along and takes his livestock, his household, his livelihood, his family, with one notable exception, to the point that his wife comes and she says, "Why don't you just curse God and die?" And he's sitting there, "Okay, God, I don't get this. Why? I've tried to live a righteous life, and this, why? Why is this happening?" Or John the Baptist. We remember we talked about him in our Journey with Jesus series, who paved the way for the Lord. He made ready the way of the Lord. He preached to people and said, "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world is coming." And when Jesus showed up, he humbly backed out. In fact, when Jesus asked him to baptize him, he said, "Oh, no, you need to be baptizing me. I can't do that." And it was John the Baptist who said, "He," meaning Jesus, "must become greater. I must become less." Well, later on, John finds himself in prison. and he's sitting in his prison cell, and he's thinking, okay, I know Jesus. I mean, he's my cousin, and Jesus is the Messiah, and I've seen him do all these miracles. Surely he will get me out of jail. And he sat, and he waited, and he sat, and he waited, and he sat, and he waited some more, to the point that finally he's starting to scratch his head going, okay, I don't get this. Jesus, I've seen him do miracles. He's capable of this. I've been loyal. I've been faithful. Why am I still sitting here? And he said, well, maybe he's not who we thought he was. And so he gets some of his followers to go, and he says, go ask Jesus, are you the one we've been waiting for, or is there someone else? In other words, okay, God, things aren't working out the way I think they should work out. This doesn't make any sense to me. Maybe there was someone else who's the Messiah. Maybe I was wrong. And we get to that point at times where we just wonder, you know, God, do you even see me here? When my wife, years ago, when my wife was teaching a preschool class, one afternoon, they took naps in the afternoon. Boy, I miss naps. I didn't appreciate them at all when I got to have them. You don't appreciate them until you don't have time for them anymore. But they took naps on these little cots every afternoon, and the cots were stackable. So when they finished, they would stack the cots and put them, you know, in a corner out of the way. So one day, they finished at nap time, and the boys liked to have a competition to see who could stack the cots the fastest, which is a great thing for the teacher most of the time because it gets it done and gets it done quickly if they're paying attention. So one day, they're stacking the cots, and all of a sudden, you hear this little muffled voice saying, I'm here, I'm here. These boys had gotten into the competition so fast, they didn't realize that one little girl who was covered up with a blanket was still on her cot. And so she's about smushed under four or five cots, just going, hey, I'm here, do you see me? And sometimes we feel that way with God. And, you know, I'd like to believe in God, but sometimes it just doesn't seem like he cares. And so today we're going to talk about that. And I wish I had answers for all of your questions. I don't. I don't have answers for all of them. But I do want to point you to the one who does. And I want to point out a couple of truths this morning about God. In those moments when we wonder, does God even care? And the first one is this, that God will always work his purpose in your pain. God will always work his purpose in your pain. Now, I need to be sure that I'm clear here. I'm not saying God causes all of your pain. It may be someone let you down. Maybe you were in a relationship with someone and they ended that relationship, and you didn't want it ended. Maybe it's through something someone has done to deliberately hurt you. Maybe you're going through pain because of decisions you've made that you shouldn't have made, that they weren't the wisest decisions. Sometimes we go through pain because God looks, and it's part of his discipline, because Scripture talks about God disciplining those he loves. In Hebrews 12:6, as the Lord disciplines the ones he loved. And you know, as a parent, sometimes discipline comes in sanctioning a child with punishment or withholding a privilege so that they'll make better decisions moving forward, or so that they'll learn to trust you more. And so sometimes the best discipline is just letting someone deal with the consequences of their actions. And sometimes that's part of the discipline God gives us, is just letting us deal with the consequences of our own sinful or just unwise choices. And that's what a good parent does. You may have heard this story from my dad when he filled in here a while back. I want you to hear this from my point of view, just in case he shared this, okay? December 30th, 1980, we were living in Harrisonburg, and University of Virginia was playing basketball against JMU. And it was Ralph Sampson's homecoming. It was Ralph's second year. He was on his way to the first of his three straight National Player of the Year titles. And they had arranged this game for him to come and play in his hometown, the return of the conquering hero. And this was a hot ticket. Godwin Hall was their gym at the time. It only seated about 5,000 people. And my dad managed somehow to get three tickets for him and me and my brother. And we were excited about this. We were so looking forward to this because we were all UVA fans. And, you know, it was such a cool thing to be able to do. There was something that my dad told me before he left the house that morning. If you do this, you won't go to the game. Now, 40-some years later, neither one of us can remember what it was he said I couldn't do. But we do agree on the fact that he said, if you do it, I'm going to give your ticket to a friend. And I don't know if I thought he was bluffing, or more likely, because my dad didn't bluff, more likely I thought I could get away with it and he wouldn't know about it until afterward, and then I'd take whatever punishment I got later on. But he couldn't undo me going to the game. And he found out about it. And he gave my ticket to a family friend. To the point that every time I have seen that family friend over the last 40-some years since this happened, he makes it a point to thank me for his ticket to that game that night. And this was simply my father saying, okay, you need to learn. And the best way to learn a lot of times is through the consequences of your own actions. You know, as a good parent, sometimes the best thing you can do for your child is to say no. Because there's either a bigger objective for them to achieve, a bigger lesson for them to learn to make better decisions. Sometimes they need to learn to trust you more. And sometimes it's just you need to learn to do better. And God is our Heavenly Father, and there is no one who loves you more than He does. And so when we call out to God and we say, God, don't you even care? It's because I'm going through this pain right now. God knows everything. And all we tend to see is the pain we're dealing with in the moment. All we tend to see are the circumstances of the moment. But God sees everything. And so in those times when He doesn't respond the way we think He should, it's not because He doesn't love us. God will work His purpose even in the midst of our pain. In fact, a lot of times He works His purpose even better when we're going through difficult circumstances. I love the way the Apostle Peter put it in 1 Peter 1. He said, so be truly glad. There is wonderful joy ahead. He says, when you're struggling, when you're suffering, don't forget, there's something better on the horizon, something far better. So there's something wonderful ahead, he says. Even though you must endure many trials for a little while. He says, there are going to be difficulties. He tells us that up front. It's one of the things I appreciate most about God. He doesn't cover it up, put us white, rose-colored glasses on us. He tells us the truth. He says, there are going to be trials that come, but they're temporary. They're not forever. Verse 7, he says, these trials will show you that your faith is genuine. It's like God helping the roots of your faith stretch deeper. And he says this. He says, it is being tested as fire tests and purifies gold, though your faith is far more precious than gold. So when your faith remains strong through many trials, it will bring you much praise and glory and honor on the day when Jesus Christ is revealed to the whole world. God works His purpose. And God will work in you and through your pain if you let him. When you hold on to him, your skin gets thicker. Your spiritual roots grow deeper. Your faith gets stronger. You develop spiritual grit that you need to get through. And that not only helps you, but it helps other people. Because one of the things that we tend not to see is the impact we can have on other people. When you're going through something difficult, there's nothing better than having somebody who's been through something very similar or the same thing who you can lean on, who can encourage you, who can give you strength. And God oftentimes allows us to go through the difficulty so that we build up our faith and we build up our strength and we build up our spiritual grit, because he sees somebody we're going to encounter down the road that we can't see right now, who we can be an encouragement to, who we can help strengthen and help their faith to grow as well. And sometimes God allows this so that his kingdom can be benefited in other ways. Steve Gallagher was an officer in the sheriff's department in Los Angeles, but his pornography addiction almost cost him his marriage, and it led him to the brink of suicide. But God walked with him through his recovery, and when he got through that, he and his wife started Pure Life Ministries that helps men overcome addictions to pornography. And his wife ministers to their wives who've been hurt so badly because of their husband's addiction. And God has used even the pain that they went through, pain that his wife didn't choose, but it's pain that came as a result of something he did, and God took it, and he's benefiting the kingdom through that because he works his purpose even in our pain. Shirley Combs had been encouraged by other people that you're such a good cook, you need to open a restaurant. And she prayed about it, and she prayed about it, and she felt, okay, God is really leading me to do this. And so she opened up her restaurant, and on opening day, no customers. But there were a few homeless people who came to the back door, and she said, well, they've got to eat too. I've got food. And she fed them. Now, over the course of time, God brought in paying customers. But Shirley kept feeding the homeless who came by. And she still does that. And she even started a shelter that has served hundreds of people in her small town. And see, God will work his purpose even in the midst of our pain, even in the midst of our difficulty, if we let him. Someone said trusting God means looking beyond what we can see to what he sees. And God will work his purpose in your pain. And we can choose to be part of the amazing things he's doing and hop on board and enjoy the ride. Or we can sit on the sidelines and we can pout about what we're going through. But God will work his purpose even in the midst of our pain. I think one of the other things that's important for us to see is that he's always present in our pain. God is always present when you're hurting. Psalm 46 says, God is our refuge and strength and ever-present help in trouble. Ever-present. In other words, whatever you're facing, he's always there. Now, my tendency is to go, okay, God, here's what I want. I want this, 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 and this. And God wants to show us that he's what we really need. He is all we need. One of my spiritual heroes is the Apostle Paul. And I think one of the reasons why is because Paul was all in everything he did. He did what he believed was right, and he did it to the best of his ability. So when he believed that the church was harmful to God's kingdom, he was out there persecuting the church. But when he met Jesus and Jesus said, no, you're harming me, I'm the Savior, and you're harming me, he did a 180, and he went just as hard in the other direction as he had gone when he was persecuting the church. And he took all of that energy and all of that dedication to preach the Word of God all over and to plant churches all over. But that didn't make Paul immune from difficulty. Paul was beaten within an inch of his life. He was bitten by a snake. He was shipwrecked. He was stoned. And I don't mean the kind where you sit there giggling and you got the munchies. I mean, he had huge rocks taken and he was beaten with those and left for dead. And he had a personal problem he was dealing with. Most scholars think that it was probably a physical issue, some kind of medical issue, but we're not told exactly what it was. But it was bad enough that three times he went to God and he said, please take this away from me. Please take this away from me. Please take this away from me. And you look at that and you think, wow, Paul wrote a big chunk of the New Testament. He planted churches all over. He preached the gospel. He was so dedicated. If there's anybody who deserves to have God say, absolutely, you want it, you got it, it was Paul. But listen to God's response after saying three times, please heal me, heal me, heal me. This is what God said in 2 Corinthians 12, verse 9. God said, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. I want you to heal me, God. This is what I need. And God says, no, I am all you need. And you need to realize that. Sometimes God doesn't do what we want because he wants us to recognize that our biggest need isn't healing. Our biggest need isn't more money. Our biggest need isn't for our painful circumstances to be taken away. Our biggest need is him. And he's there, and he's present in our pain. And he's there to walk with us through it. And he's there whenever you're going through something. But we have to take our mind off of self long enough to recognize him. And when it happens, when you recognize it, it's amazing. Now, I'll be honest with you. This is a thing that's kind of hard to describe. It's kind of one of those things you have to go through at some point because it's hard to describe. And I've heard people say, and I've experienced it, that, you know, I don't know how I was going to get through this. I don't know how I was going to get through this difficult time. And yet, when I needed it the most, God provided strength. He provided a shoulder to cry on. He provided just the hope that I needed. I don't know how he did it. I don't know how it worked, but I know he was there. And that's what God does. That's what he does for us. He is there even in the midst of our pain. When he doesn't say, okay, I'll take it all away, he doesn't just abandon us. He is right there with us, and he's working even in the midst of it. And so Paul would go on to say, after God said, no, my grace is enough for you. You don't need relief from this right now. What you need is me. You need to learn to depend on me more. And Paul went on to say, you know, that was a good thing. Verse 9, he said, therefore I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That's why, for Christ's sake, and listen to this because it's going to sound kind of crazy, it says, I delight in weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. Do you delight in being weak, and being persecuted, and going through hardship? He says, I delight in them. I take pleasure in them. How in the world can you say that, Paul? He says, for when I am weak, then I am strong. He says, it's in those times. I can delight in these things when I don't have any more strength, because it's in those moments that I'm relying on God's strength. And God's strength is so much greater than my greatest strength. It dwarfs the strength I think I have. And God's strength is so much greater. In those moments, God is always with us in our pain. And we say, God, I don't understand this. Why? It doesn't seem like you care. One of the things that you hear along those lines a lot of times is, why does God let bad things happen to good people? I mean, you look at somebody who's going along and they're doing terrible things to people and crime after crime, and they seem to get turned back out on the street to do more, and they seem to profit from all this. And then you see people who are trying to do the right thing, and they're struggling just to make it day to day. And why does God let bad things happen to good people? Isn't he fair? Well, God is always just, but he's not always fair. And let me tell you, that's such a good thing for us, that he's not fair. Because if he were fair, he would have to deal with us in our sin. He would have to punish us for our sin. But God is just. Sin has to be accounted for. But because he's not fair, he didn't make us pay for our sin. He stepped down from heaven, put on human form, and sacrificed himself and took that punishment for us. Was that fair? No. Wasn't fair for him or us. But it was grace. And he loved us enough to do that for us. Psalm 103 says this. It says, he does not treat us as our sins deserve or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. And listen to this part. This is amazing. As far as the east is from the west, so far he has removed our transgressions from us. I love that description. As far as the east is from the west. You know how far it is from the north to the south? It's exactly 12,416 miles from the North Pole to the South Pole. If you start heading north to the North Pole, there's a point where you pass the North Pole and then you're heading south again. It's a big distance, but it's a fixed distance. You know how far it is from the east to the west? It's infinite. Because if you got on a plane and you start heading east, you're always heading east. You may cover some of the same ground, but you're always heading east. East and west never meet. And he says, that's how much God loves you. That's how unfair he is in our favor. That he takes our sins that we deserve to pay for, and he removes them as far as the east is from the west. And so in those times when you're tempted to grouse and complain and say, God, I'm doing a Bible study for you. Why are you making my car not start? I want to challenge you to, instead of just thinking about things from your perspective in the moment, to start to think about things from God's perspective, from the perspective of our Heavenly Father who loves us more than we can possibly imagine, to realize that sometimes there's a reason we don't understand for why God doesn't always respond the way we want. I heard a preacher not too long ago talk about a nurse, and I may have shared this with some of you. If I have, just pretend I didn't, okay? But he had a nurse in his congregation who worked in the pediatric burn unit. I can't imagine. I mean, it'd be hard enough working in the burn unit, period, but let alone the pediatric one. And she told about when she was doing her training, part of it was she was paired with an experienced nurse, and they had a child who came in with some bad burns. And part of the procedure is to get rid of the dead tissue. And that's a painful process. And she said she watched as they strapped the child down, and this nurse took a wire brush and started scraping off and cleaning off that burned dead tissue. And she heard, apparently, I don't know what the situation was, but apparently the child couldn't be completely sedated, and the child was screaming, and she said, I could never, ever put a child through that kind of pain. But she said the next day when she came into work and she said I could never do that. I can't do it. She said the nurse took a book and showed her the before and after pictures of several patients who hadn't had that happen, who the tissue was allowed to just heal as it was. And she said they had no range of motion. They couldn't stretch their arms out. They couldn't do the simplest things because that dead tissue just takes away the ability to stretch. That when you clear that out and you let fresh tissue come as the body heals, that it is able to stretch and move. And their quality of life is so much better. And she said, I walked away that afternoon realizing that as hard as it was, there are times when the payoff for going through a little bit of pain in the moment is far greater than the difficulty of the pain that we're facing. You know, we read from Psalm 13 as we started, where David was just crying out to God. Saul was trying to kill him, and he, God, why in the world are you letting this happen? I'm supposed to be the one you've anointed to be king, and why are you letting this happen? He's trying to kill me. Are you listening? Are you there? Do you care? Listen to how he finishes up Psalm 13, verses 4 and 5. He says this, but I trust in your unfailing love. My heart rejoices in your salvation. I will sing the Lord's praise, for he has been good to me. Even with all the things going on that he didn't understand, he fell back on the fact that God has demonstrated unfailing love to him. And he demonstrated that especially in his salvation. And no matter what, no matter what kind of difficulty he faced, he said, I'm going to sing God's praises. He recognized that God's salvation is the greatest blessing we could ever receive. And the payoff we get from that is eternal. And it's far greater than any momentary pain that he allows us to go through. And that he's always present with us, even in that pain. And that he will work his purpose through any pain we go through. Let's pray together. Lord, it's so easy for us to get focused on our circumstances and self, to be honest, that we get to where we're just wrapped up in our own little world and we question you. And we know you're big enough to take questions, but Lord, I pray that you would help us to move beyond that and to recognize that no matter what we face, you're there. I pray that you'd help us to lean on you and to recognize that you are all we need. The things that we think will solve all our problems, that you are the one we need. And to look for those ways where you can work your purpose, even in the midst of pain. And we thank you for the fact that you've promised that there is something so much better that we can look forward to. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you don't have that hope that there's something better, then we want to give you the opportunity to take hold of that, to respond to his invitation for salvation, to confess him as Lord and Savior and be baptized into him and have your sins washed away. If there's a decision you need to make, would you do that as we stand together and sing this morning?
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation can't be revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is, what a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ is my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name.
The name of Jesus. And the challenges we leave today for all of us, myself included, is to trust his name. And when difficult things come, to turn our thoughts to him and say, Lord, how can you use this to build your kingdom? God bless you. Have a great week.